Okay, I'll do a short little video on my new rolling block here, or all new to me. See, it's a 1875 Carl Gustaf. And this is the first sort of commercially built sporter rolling block that I've bought. Was done by like Vapen to Potten, or one of those companies in Sweden. They did a lot of conversions like this of military guns. There's like these 12mm Remington rolling blocks were done. Some of these rolling blocks were converted to like 8x58 in the 1890s, and then those were converted in a very similar fashion, or a lot of them. And same with like the Mauser rifles, the 6.5s. And some of them were converted to like 8x54 and things like this. And very, very similar the way the sights are, stocks. The only difference is the action. There was also like Husqvarna built a lot of guns that look similar to this, but they were just commercially built guns. They don't have, like, these are military actions they used in these conversions, but those other ones were like new built actions. That was a very, very popular action in Sweden. It was like the number one Remington action. They used it for rifles, shotguns, stuff like that for quite a few years. These were rimfire to start with. And pretty much all of them were converted to center fire when they were sold to exporters or sportsmen and civilians and whatever. But you still, I guess there's a few rim fires you still run into. Some were just changed to center fire and left in military configuration, because I think some were sort of used by some militia groups for a while, but I'm not really sure about that. But the official military round was a rim fire, and that was used in some sporters that were built earlier on, but then after it wasn't a military gun anymore, then that ammo would have sort of become hard to find. So they went to center fire, and you could reload your own ammo, and black powder ammo was really easy to deal with. You just fill it full of powder and jam a bullet in it. But anyway, we'll just go over some of the features of this gun, what they did to it. As I said, it was like an 1875 Carl Gustaf, so it does have a steel barrel and receiver, or well, black powder steel. They lopped the barrels off pretty much on pretty much all of them. It's pretty similar. This one's about 33 inches. They were 37. They put some sort of new front sight on it. This one's a very low little bead sight. Some have like a V sight here. I'm not sure if that's original or not, because the thing shoots like a mile high with that low sight. But they put a sling swivel here. Soldered it on the barrel here. Yeah, zoom back here for you. They shortened the wood, sort of rounded it off here. They also added a pin here that goes, there's a square lug that's part of the barrel here. And originally, like, the wood has a hole in it that the lug goes into. Originally had the barrel band, so that would hold the wood on. But as soon as you take the barrel bands off, then the wood would just fall off. So they drill the holes through that lug and then put these pins in them. Some are not very good. Some are, like, these commercial ones are pretty decent. It's actually a real pin, but some of the civilian sporterized ones, they put like square nails through them and weird stuff like that. But, and some just still had barrel bands left on and things. But they changed the back sight. If you can see or not, but you can see the remnants of where the old back sight was set in this area. This new sight, they dovetailed it into the barrel here, and you got a V sight there, a fixed sight, and then you got the flip up part. So I'm not sure what the distances were. They were fairly close range stuff, because if you sight the, like, this lower setting for too far out, then you have a be pretty high at like mid-range, so it'd be sort of not very useful for shooting anything closer. So I'm kind of thinking you probably have like a 70 some meter sight here, and then this flip up one be like 150 or 120 at the most, because even if you set this at like 100 meters, the lowest setting, it's still, I suppose that's not too bad, because that'd be, it's only about the most of this type of ammo for this thing would have been 4 or 5 inches at high at 50, which isn't too bad considering these for shooting at moose and stuff, and moose are pretty big. They refinished the stock here. It's quite dark. They sort of put a stain and a like a varnish onto it. These are more of a lighter kind of a walnut, I guess. They blued the action here. We did all this, cleaned it up, because these were have been just case color hardened originally, and I think the barrels were blued originally, but they re-blued those because they would have had to when they scraped the old sight off, because I think the old sight was like soldered on the barrel here. And they didn't blue the block or the hammer or the different pins. They left those in the white, but as I said, they changed these from rim fire to center fire, and I'll see if I can zoom in enough you can see it here. So there's the new firing pin there, and then below it you can see the shadow of where the old hole was. They plugged it and then sort of made it cut it flush. So, but that's what the you'll see that on most of these Swedish rolling blocks. You'll see where they plugged the old hole, but some of the backwoods ones are not that well done. Some of them, like I got one, the hole's not even plugged very well, or it's still, you can still see where the old hole is. But this one's pretty good and tight. There's no wobble or anything in it. So other than that, there's not a whole lot they did to the back. It's just restained the stock here, refinished it. I put a sling swivel here because the old military one was there, but that was too far forward when he had when the one on the barrel, so they cut those off, and then they put the screwed in one in the wood here. This one's got a little plate on it. Looks like, I don't know, AH or something. I don't know what the hell. Some have different identifying things. Maybe this is like Adolf Hitler's hunting gun. I don't know. Anyway. And this has got the Remington style locking plate on it. Holds the two pins in. But a lot of them have two locking screws on them. Well, I think a lot of the Husqvarna ones have locking screws, but the Carl Gustaf ones have locking plate. But they seem like, I think they both used them or tried them at one time, but I don't know, they found out that the locking screws, I don't know, they don't really have any advantage over this. Because like these pins, you can put them in any way, it doesn't really matter, and you just put the plate over top of them. The locking screw ones, the pins have little cutouts that the screw goes into, and if they're not the right way, you can't tighten the locking screw on. So it's sort of, not really sure, and I think it's, I don't know if it caused them to become loose because the screws were always in the same place or something, and they would wear on the same side. I don't know if it made a difference, but I think, see with this, if you have like these are bigger components, are harder to lose. Like those little locking screws, if you lost one, then that pin's gonna fall out on you. So it's, I don't know why they really tried it or did away with it, or they didn't find it was a good idea. But anyway, this thing's in pretty good shape, really, really good shape actually. Really good barrel on it. It's in the, so that'd be probably my new favorite hunting gun for now. Usually one of the cartridges I made up for it, or actually Ward cut it down and kneel it for me, but so instead of a 50-70, it's just shortened a little bit, and the rim is turned down a tiny little bit. Some of these guns, I don't think will, actually I think they'll all take a 50-70 if you cut the rim off a little bit, shorten them, and turn, some of you may have to turn it down a tiny little bit around the head area here. There's a lot of people saying, oh, 50-70 is way too big, but we haven't really encountered one yet that, you can't like modify a 50-70 case to work with it, and they're a whole lot easier to deal with. Like the 348 in a lot of ways are a pain in the fucking ass, so they go in right nice. So there they closes and extract easy. I just find they're a whole lot easier to deal with, and if you can, this brass is really good brass too. It's Sterline stuff. It's a little bit, you know, it's kind of tiny bit expensive, but it's about a dollar a shell or so, but that's pretty good considering what you're getting, a horribly obsolete cartridge like 50-70. But So that's why I use in that one. Some of the other ones, you could, the rim didn't have to be turned down as much, but it's, I think it's got a, usually have to do with this area here, where the shell goes in, or the rim sits in. This has to be, see the rim actually sort of sits in there. Rim has to actually sit in around in the barrel here. So that's where you gotta cut the rim down. And you don't wanna, and you can't force like a rolling block, because this extractor is like the weakest part of this whole design, is this little extractor, because it just slides back and forth and it's actuated by the block here. So if you gotta force it, you'll end up breaking the, there's just a little nib on the extractor there, and you'll end up fucking buggering it up. So it's good. You make sure the things fit properly before you start messing with them. But I made these ones here the other day that we made up, fired them the other day, and they work great. So no extraction problems or anything. So, but anyway, I'm really happy with it. And if you can get one of these, well, if you want, like this, you could buy one just like this, and you can put tang sights on, and they'll shoot all, pretty much better than a lot of the replicas or reproductions you can buy now. Because okay, what I was saying there, Dad's, his is 1876, and with them tang sight on, or decent sights, you can shoot about an inch at 100 yards, and that's better than some of the reproductions can do. It just shows you the old stuff is just as good. If your barrel is okay, and you had a decent load for it. But anyway, and the, you know, these are like $400. So just considering that the reproductions are, I don't know, 1,000 for a decent one. So anyway.